Well, I want to begin with a question, and it's a rhetorical question. I would ask you this: are you content? And I want you to answer it. I want you to think about that. Are you content? Content is not the same thing as happy. Content is not the same thing as rich or poor or anything like that. But would you say that if someone were to ask you, would you go to answer, I'm content with life? Again, it's a rhetorical question. But are you content? Why? Or why not? Why? How would you answer that? What would you say? When are you content? How are you content? What does it mean to be content? We live in a time when, by any measure possible, any way you want to measure it, we are physically, financially, materially better off. Infant mortality is low. Cures for horrific diseases are being discovered every year. As I was doing some research for this message, I realized, I knew it was recent, but I didn't realize how recent it was. Penicillin was only discovered in 1928. There are people living in Flathead County. There are people that are our neighbors that were born before penicillin was discovered. And it's something that now you can go to Publix and it's one of their free prescriptions. I guess it's amoxicillin now. I don't want to use penicillin in pure form anymore, but you can go, I'll give it to you because it's so common. But think about that, less than 100 years ago, we didn't even know that that could be used in antibiotics. Certain common sicknesses simply killed you. My great-grandfather died on my dad's side in 1918 of the Spanish flu. It's incredible, and here we are 100 years later, and we have cures for diseases that they couldn't even comprehend even a few years ago. Air conditioning? Guess why the population of Florida is now about 20 million? Air conditioning, okay? Because people like me and Nancy and many of us from the north, we wouldn't have lived here 100 years ago when it was 90 degrees for like half the year. And now we have air conditioning everywhere. In our cars, in our houses, in your campers, in your tents, in your whatever. In fact, we are so blessed that I walk in a Target, it's a little bit cold. You know, I walk in and see the thing is, I can see by the knowledge, you guys know what I'm talking about. It is perfect in there. You know, it should be like 78, 77, one. You go, that's a little cold. It is absolutely perfect, which is how I expect it all the time. Cars, they're more advanced. And contrary to what you may think by the tags and windows, they're way cheaper for what you get than they were 20, 30, 40 years ago. I know the actual price is higher. But I mean, you get an accident and everything turns into a balloon. You've got connections to satellites in most cars. You've got devices that tell you where to go. I mentioned I was in Tampa yesterday for this funeral. And my phone is telling you where to go every step of the way. Because I put my map app. We used to say MapQuest, I still say that, but the Apple map app, I just put in the address and it tells me where, I have no idea where I'm going. It just tells me, and they're really nice, and you can set the voice. Some of them don't, you know, I'm talking about, you can change the voice. And so I've got this really sweet woman from New Zealand on my phone who tells me, you should turn my Kiwi accent, but she'll tell me where to turn and where to go and how far. Hey, 10 miles, you can take on a left. 1 mile, you can take on a left, that sort of thing. Technology is getting more advanced, and computers and technology are cheaper. I finally, after 5 years, I upgraded to a larger iPad. I've preached from my iPad mini for 5 years, and the iPads now, the new version at least, is quite a bit cheaper than what my iPad would have cost 5 years ago. And I did get a bigger one because, for some reason, the print on my iPad is getting smaller. I don't understand how that works, but I figured, you know, I'd get one where maybe the print was a little bigger for some strange reason. The print is getting smaller. Technology is incredible. I went into to Best Buy, and I've got my phone with me in my pocket, and I'm purchasing my iPad, and the guy asked me if I want the Apple Care Protection, and it was like $50, $60, and I thought, I better do that, because I just broke the screen on my phone. And he said, oh, really? So, yeah, I was out running, I had my belt, and when I got to running, I tried to pull it out, and somehow it projected out of my flip belt, and it went smashing to the ground. The screen was all jacked up, all messed up. And I showed the guy, I said, yeah, my phone, the screen's all broken. And he said, are you sure that's not just the screen protector? I think your screen is actually fine. And this was about the fourth or fifth person that had assured me, I think your screen's okay, I think it's just a protector on top. And one of them was my son, which I can't come to admit now, that he was right. I said, no, it's a screen. If you look at an angle, and I said, in fact, if you pull back the protector, and then as I pulled back the protector for the first time since I broke it, I realized, oh, screen's not broken. Wow. And I pulled the protector off, and my screen was perfect, and I just plugged the protector in. And I'm just, maybe you're not, I'm amazed by technology. I've got a handheld computer in my pocket that has, I don't know, 128 gigabytes or 256 gigabytes of memory. My first computer in college had like 900 megabytes. And I'm carrying this in my pocket. And it's cheap compared to what we were paying for computers in the past. From a material perspective, life is really good. Amen. We from a material perspective, not said spiritually yet, from a material perspective, it's way better. And yet, people are just content. Don't you feel it? People are mad. They're fuses. I don't know, and I'm going to offend some of you. I don't know if it's because I grew up in the bubble of Minnesota nice, in Minnesota where everybody really pretended to be nice. I don't think it's regional. I think it's something that is in the water, something's in the air, where people just, they're mad! And, you know, I see it when I'm out running. Crosswalks do apparently not mean the same thing they used to mean. They used to mean that, hey, if a pedestrian's in a crosswalk, you stop. And now apparently it means you speed up. And I you know, if you do that to me, by the way, you're going to get like this. What are you, I'm going to do that. I've done that to cars recently. I thought, you know, that could be somebody in church. That could be somebody, but it doesn't mean, people just, they're in a hurry, and they're mad, they're discontent, and something's going on. And some people point to social media as one of the reasons for it. Now, before I go any further, the full story, let's lay it out on the table. I love social media. Y'all, please go to your friends with me on Facebook. You see me on Facebook. I unabashedly use it. I contemplate my use of it because I don't know sometimes what the point is. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. I'm connected to people that I would not be connected to. From mass churches, from college, high school, grade school, co-workers in the past. I wouldn't be connected to them, and I cherish that. I don't know, I have these moments where I want to quit Facebook, but then I realize I'm connected to so many people that I wouldn't be connected to. I don't have another way of doing that. And it's not valid. I wouldn't even know how to do that, but here's what I'm going to do. I don't know if Facebook was invented. So, I wrestle with wanting to keep it, but I am keeping it, and at the same time, I recognize the dangers of it. Social media appears to breed jealousy, anxiety, discontent. We're going to talk about the truths of that in just a moment. What I want to do this morning is I want to unpack that, and I want to start with the verse that speaks to contentment. And so the verse I'm going to read is from Philippians chapter 4, verses 10 through 19. It'll be up on the screen behind me. Maybe. I just looked this up video, and I do apologize for having troubles with that. But it will be up on the screen. I'm going to, of course, read out loud. If you've got any paper Bibles, it's in Philippians chapter 4, verses 10 through 19. Some of you have them online. If you've got the YouVersion Bible, remember that we have an event on there. I remind you each week. If you go on your phone, if you've got the Bible app, you go to the lower right and look for events, and we'll have the scripture and the sermon notes in there. So this is Philippians chapter 4, verses 10 through 19. And Paul writes this, how I praise the Lord that you're concerned about me again. I know that you've always been concerned for me, but you didn't have the chance to help me. Not that I was ever in need, for I have learned to be content with whatever I have. If you've got paper Bibles, that would be one to underline highlight and mark. I know how to live, Paul says, in almost nothing or with everything. I've learned the secret of living every situation, whether it is with a full stomach or empty, with plenty or little. Verse 13, one of the greatest verses of the Bible, for I can do everything through Christ, who gives me strength. Even so, you have done well to share with me my present difficulty. As you know, the Philippians were the only ones who gave me financial help. You Philippians were the only ones who gave me financial help when I first brought you the good news and then traveled on from Macedonia. No other church did this. Even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent help more than once. I don't say this because I want a gift from you. In other words, Paul isn't asking for more. He says, rather, I want you to receive a reward for your kindness. Now I'm going to pause for a second. Christians, do you realize sometimes thank you is a huge reward for what you're thinking? I know I fall short sometimes in saying thank you, and maybe you're like me, but sometimes the simple word of thanks really blesses somebody. I mentioned doing this funeral yesterday down in Tampa, and the family, which kind of blows my mind, thanked me for being there. I'm in the Army. I didn't tell them, well, you know, I had to be here. The colonel said, you're going there. So, okay, sir, you know, I obviously, if there was some reason I didn't want to do it, I would tell them that's never happened. But that, just simple word, thank you for being there, that means a lot to me. That means a lot to me. It made my day. Paul continues on in verse 18. He says, at the moment, I have all I need, and more. I am generously supplied with the gifts you sent me, with Epaphroditus. They are a sweet smelling sacrifice and acceptable and pleasing to God. And the same God who takes care of me will supply all of your needs from his glorious riches, which have been given to us in Christ Jesus. Amen. Over the next 5 weeks, we're going to unpack some of the modern struggles that we have. And there are struggles that interfere with biblical values. Today we're going to talk about contentment. Let me talk about where we're going with the sermon series. And we're using kind of a silly title for the sermon series. It's called Hashtag Struggles. If you're on social media, you've never done so, I encourage you to go home today, get on Twitter, and put that in search engine, Hashtag Struggles. And you'll see a lot of responses, some of them sarcastic, some of them, I think, serious about what people perceive as struggles. And it's kind of incredible because I would maintain, as a modern society, have lost a lot of our ability to deal with the difficulties of life. Our resilience, our ability to deal with need or struggle or discomfort, sometimes I feel like it's almost zero. And I include myself in it. I'm not saying, hey, all these people, they don't know how to deal with struggles. I think collectively, we don't deal with it the way I think our ancestors and people 50, 60, 70, 80, 100, 150, 200 years ago would. So what we're going to talk about contentment today. We're going to talk about intimacy. We're going to talk about authenticity. We're going to talk about compassion. We're going to talk about rest. And in terms of intimacy, we are more connected than we've ever been as a culture. And yet I think it's very easy to argue that we've lost the art of intimacy. We've lost the ability of face-to-face, eye-to-eye conversation. As we become more technologically driven, we connect less in person, we're more afraid to talk. We have the illusion of companionship, but we don't have the demands of friendship. It's easy to ignore somebody online, or when they send you a text, or when they send you an email. It's a little different when they're face-to-face. They're going through a struggle. Authenticity, we can filter everything we show people. We can self-edit. And I'm sure none of you do this online. But there are people that apparently only show the good stuff online. I've heard it. I've heard there are some people that only show the good stuff in their lives online. And of course it isn't you, it isn't me. But there are people out there that only show the best and they struggle with being authentic. Compassion. Some would argue, I would be one of them, that we care less about people than we did even 15, 20 years ago. I don't know how you measure that. It's a sense I get. Maybe I'm wrong, and if I am, wonderful. If that's true, it definitely runs contrary to God's will that we live with compassion and rest. I read that something like 80% of teenagers sleep with their phones. And of course, none of you adults do that. I'm sure nobody else does it. Nobody else has their phone anywhere near their bed. We're just talking about other people somewhere else. We're always connected. Email can be checked constantly. Texts are expected to be replied to immediately. Even, and this is okay because of my operational tempo in my life, but as I was working on this part of the sermon, I looked up and it was 5:30 in the morning. Because of my laptop, I can work anywhere, on anything, at any time. And I wonder how healthy is that really? So today we're going to talk for a bit about contentment. We're going to compare and contrast it to what Paul's saying in Philippians chapter 4. And contentment, it really deals with the fact that the more we compare, the less satisfied we are. We're going to talk about the heart of discontent is comparison that sees someone else having something bigger, better, more expensive. And this is a problem in our culture. The attitude of comparison is one that will leave you discontent. Again, we're using the hashtag title struggles because that's a popular social media tag. And again, I encourage you to go ahead and throw it on Twitter and see what you come up with. So I want to talk for a few minutes about social media as we dive into this. So what role does social media play? Well, the trouble with social media is the perception that everyone else's life is perfect. Follow me? If you get on Facebook, or Twitter, I suppose, but really it's a Facebook thing, the perception is everyone else has it going on. Everyone else is eating the perfect meals, with the perfect family, in the perfect place. They're sending pictures of their vacation, and they're sending pictures of their job, they're sending pictures, you know, of their Bible study or whatever, and everyone's life is so good. Let me show you an example of this. Any of you, I don't want you to raise your hands, do any of you tweet pictures of your meals? That's a rhetorical question. But you've seen it, even if you don't do it, you've seen people who throw a picture online, this is what I'm eating now. It always, it kind of makes you feel a little bad as I'm eating my tombstone pizza. Well, I'm glad somebody's eating well, you know, but apparently I'm not. That's my lunch from earlier this week. Isn't that pretty? I took a staged picture. I'm going to turn around so I can click this. That is a borderless enchilada. Look at those flowers. It just happened to be sitting there. And I did a little filter going on. I put some silverware out and put that on a tray that says something in Swedish. And this is the meal before I cooked it. Okay, that, and then do you see how my health papers are so perfectly placed? Okay, that's what I was eating. That is actually something I eat quite a bit because you can throw it in a microwave and it takes just a few minutes to prepare, and I just don't feel like taking that much time to eat. It's got 27 grams of protein. That's how I got these arms. That's my meal. So, you know, what role does social media play? I don't know. But the reality is oftentimes quite different than what's shown in the photo. Do you ever feel it when you're going on Facebook? You look at the family activities of others, you fall short. I didn't take my kids parasailing in Switzerland for vacation this year. We cobbled together enough money to buy some food at SeaWorld. We got it for free because I'm in the army, you know. But that family is parasailing with their kids in Switzerland. Hey, hashtag fun, you know. And so casual as they sail down the mountains of places I've probably never seen. Or maybe see the exercise posts or videos of others Oreos going in your mouth, you know. Throwing Oreos down and then something shows a picture like, hey, I just ran 73 miles today, you know. I only average like 6:05. I feel bad about that. Or maybe like the picture I threw up there, you know, somebody, you know, posts a picture of the perfect meal and the perfect setting with the perfect drink and the perfect food, and meanwhile you're like me, you're cooking that tombstone. I love tombstone pizza, by the way. It's not different than the church world. As a pastor, and I'm going to confess to this, you know, and I've done it in the past as well, and I'll probably do it again in the future. Somebody posted a picture of 6,000 people in worship. I'm calling out some cloudy today. We didn't have that many people show up. You know, then you start to take it personally. Don't these posts, I'm not a good enough parent. I'm not a good enough student. I'm not a good enough cook. I don't exercise enough. I'm not a good enough preacher. I'm not, and we become discontent because we're looking at what other people are doing. Follow me? There's a study that I found, Harvard Business Review, so it's got to be true. But A new, more, the tagline is, a new, more rigorous study confirms, the more you use Facebook, the worse you feel. I don't know why they need a study to say that, but apparently, you know, somebody has studied this. And let me just, here are a few things I kind of highlighted. The average Facebook user spends almost an hour on the site every day. Average. I know it's not you because you guys all spend like 5 minutes a year and older than that. But the average person spends about an hour on the site every day, according to data provided by the company last year. Survey found that for many smartphone users, checking social media apps are the first thing they do in the morning, often before even getting out of bed. And then down further, prior research, which this study reinforced, has shown that the use of social media may detract from face-to-face relationships, reduce investment in meaningful activities, increase sedentary behavior by encouraging more screen time, lead to internet addiction, and erode self-esteem through unfavorable social comparison. Self-comparison can be a strong influence on human behavior because people tend to display the most positive aspects of their lives on social media. It is possible for an individual to believe that their own life compares negatively to what they see presented by others. To put it in normal speak, when you see somebody's perfect life online, you're small short in comparison. And then the last part says that because we expected that liking other people's content would be more likely to lead to negative self-comparisons and thus decrease in well-being, updates from it, they found interesting, I should say, that updating one's own status and clicking links seemed to have a similar effect. And so not only liking somebody's status, but even posting updates and clicking on links on Facebook, they found, and I guess you can dispute to me or you can argue with them, but they found that it decreases people's own happiness and increases negative self-comparisons. And they found that our well-being results not only from quantity, but also from quality of use. As you can see, I'm only on Facebook for like 5-6 minutes. But they found it doesn't even really matter the amount of time. If you're interacting with it, there's a good chance that you're feeling not quite as happy when you're done. So, what do we as Christians have to say about it? Well, I think the first thing we need to say is that the issue isn't social media itself. The issue isn't social media itself. The issue is something called sin. Amen? It doesn't matter what the medium is. Social media highlights what's already there, and it's called sin. Social media didn't create discontent. It didn't create jealousy. It didn't create comparisons. It didn't create competition. It didn't create felt alike. Now, it may be helping it to happen faster, but the issue is our understanding of ourselves and the sin that attaches itself to that. So, the first thing we have to do as Christians then is to expose discontentment. Expose discontentment. Where do you find yourself discontent? Maybe it's material or financial discontent, cars, houses, purses, clothing. Commercials don't help, do they? There's a really catchy commercial. And I finally admit to myself that I find this song catchy because it is the most materialistic nonsense. It's an eBay commercial where they show people shopping for form patterns. And it's all women in commercial. So they're obviously targeting a certain audience. I know that surprisingly maybe not shopping for prints or patterns or whatever. And they're showing women ordering stuff on eBay, and the commercial music ramps up. It's such a catchy song. And then like it crescendos with individual, you know, they have this thing, and I'm not gonna try to sing it. I hate to imagine, I'm trying to figure out what the song is, because it would be a kind of good song to run to, and I don't know what the song is. But there's all kinds of stuff out there just saying, buy, 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 you need stuff, 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 and if you don't have all that stuff, you're not going to be happy. Sometimes the discontent is relational. Maybe you feel like you haven't been invited to something, or maybe you haven't actually been invited to something. Maybe you're married and it isn't what you see on Facebook. Maybe you're not married and you feel like you're supposed to be. I remember years ago, this is long before Facebook, long before a lot of social comparisons online, I was counseling a couple who said something to me about, and this was in my first church of the Cross, which is a 2,000-member church. It's just hard coming here with all these perfect families, which makes me kind of chuckle because I know the truth. You know, everybody's got issues. But their perception was all these perfect people were around. Sometimes it's circumstantial. At this point in life, I was supposed to have A, B, C, and D. I was supposed to have X number of kids. I was supposed to be at this point in my career. I was supposed to fill in the blank. Discontent can be material, relational, or financial. It can be relational, it can be circumstantial. And so for us as Christians, it's about intentionally identifying those areas and then giving them the perspective of faith. Let me go back to Philippians chapter 4, verses 12 and 13. Paul said, I know how to live with almost nothing or with everything. I've learned the secret of living in every situation, whether it is with a full stomach or empty, with plenty or with little, for I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength. A few things on that. First of all, being content isn't about how much you have. Amen? Amen? Somebody's going, oh, the way I always is about how much you have. I just want to vote, it's awesome. You know, I'm happy now. Being content isn't about how much you have. And being content, by the way, is not the same thing as being happy. What the secret is the strength that God gives us in Christ. And let me pause there for a second. The strength God gives us. It doesn't come from within. It's not something we do. It's not something we think. It's about surrendering yourself to what God will do in Jesus Christ. If Christ is all you need, you'll be content. If Christ is all you need, you'll be content. If he isn't enough, you will always struggle with discontent. You will always know how much money, how much fame, how much fortune, how much phone line. You will always be unhappy because it will never be enough. So, we're living through Christ's strength. And through his strength then, through Christ's strength, what we need to do is we need to kill comparisons. Through Christ's strength, we need to kill comparisons. And I've got on the screen 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12. This is Paul writing again, this time the church in Corinthians. He says, don't worry. We wouldn't dare say that we are as wonderful as other men who tell you how important they are. Can you sense the sarcasm? Don't worry. We're not going to fight with them. They're so important. They're telling you how important they are. But they're only comparing themselves with each other, using themselves as a standard of measure. How ignorant, Paul says. If we don't kill them first, comparisons will kill us. And do you recognize, and I think this is where Paul's going with this, how silly comparisons must seem to God? That we're a little more famous in comparison. We're a little more wealthier. You've got a 3,000 square foot house instead of a 2,000 square foot house when God has the whole universe. And how tiny, and how from a size perspective, how insignificant this planet is in the grand scheme of things. And we lord it over others because we have 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 extra square feet than them. That in our minds, is making it. Comparison will kill us if we don't kill it first. Look around you. There is someone who's going to best you. Maybe you watch HGTV. I just wonder about these first-time homebuyers with a budget of like $800,000. Who are they? And I know they're not pastoring your church, and I get it's a different pay scale, but who are they? You know, we're buying a house, and we're living in an apartment right now, and renting, and it's just not quite enough space, and so we're looking at houses, and our budget is, $700,000. Who are they? And do they tithe? Here's what I want to know. I'm just kidding about that. Kind of kidding. No, actually. Now, if they were here, I'd say, hey, you should totally tithe. I saw an article There was a kid who applied to like 20 schools, like all the Ivy League schools, Stanford. You know what I'm talking about? And he got into all of them. And then I said, you're in ninth grade. My counselor told me, you're not going to Stanford. Because I already didn't have all A's. In ninth grade. Do you understand that's the first grade of high school? My counselor at Corona Del Mar High School in Southern California, when they first started having me, hey, let's start talking about college. I said, yeah, I want to go to Stanford. And you know why I wanted to go there? Because John Elway went there. And he played quarterback. And he was good. I didn't, and I wasn't. But I wanted to go there, and my counselor smashed my dreams at like age, 14? Yeah, you're not going there. In fact, I can still picture the sarcasm. You're not going there. You need all A's, and then you need to do something special, like, you know, win a rodeo or something like that. He didn't say that. That was in my mind. And this kid, I applied to like every school, and I got into them all. I didn't know where I'll go. The person needs whatever she wants, whatever he wants, with apparently no offense. The athlete with natural talent. The investor who loses more in a day than you'll make in a couple years. That person. There will always be somebody envy. And if you live that way, it's going to kill you. If you live that way, it's going to kill you. But even worse is that it isn't Christian. It's not spiritual, and it has its roots. My thoughts. James chapter 3 says this, verses 14 to 16. He says, but if you are bitter with jealous, and there is selfish ambition in your heart, don't cover up the truth with boasting and lying. For jealousy and selfishness are not God's kind of wisdom. Such things are earthly, unspiritual, and demonic. People don't talk about it anymore, do they? Everything's great. Everything's fine. Everything's happening. And James cuts to the chase. You think that way? It's earthly, it's unspiritual, and it's demonic. It is not good. For wherever, James says, there's jealousy and selfish ambition, there you will find disorder and evil of every kind. Look at those words. Again. Earthly. Unspiritual. Demonic. And so, Christians, we need to kill comparisons. We have got to stop comparisons in its tracks. How do you do it? Well, it begins with surrender to Christ and asking Him to be your everything. And then there are practical steps as well, although that is 99.9% of it, is to surrender yourself to Christ. Maybe you need to take a social media break. I've done that here and there. I'll get off Facebook for a month, and it's amazing what it will do. If you've never done that and that's an issue, I challenge you to do that. Maybe you need to hide the feet of certain people who you recognize, not for your own fault necessarily, but they trigger certain emotions. They trigger jealousy. They trigger sinful thoughts in your heart. You can download stuff in a browser. I actually downloaded something called Social Fixer for my Chrome browser, mainly because I was tired of seeing people's posts on politics. I'm sorry, I don't want to see it. You are not going to convince me on Facebook whether or not the NRA is good or bad, whether or not abortion should or shouldn't be legal, whether or not you're not going to convince me. I don't make voting choices, surprisingly enough, based on your Facebook posts. I've got to make my own decisions. I don't want to see it. I'm tired of seeing it. And so I was actually talking to Craig Alsop, who preached at Beachside back in January, a missionary into Asia. He was one who suggested, hey, there's this thing for Facebook called Social Fixer. And I downloaded it, and it is 99% awesome. There's one problem with it, I'll warn you ahead of time. It allows you, and you do not want to see this, it allows you to see who defriends you. This is not good. This is not, the first day I installed it, within like 24 hours, four people had defriended me. And I realized, as a pastor who cares about people, I'm going, who, why? And I realized, people on Facebook, apparently, one of them was a long-distance cousin, and I determined that she had left Facebook. Another was somebody closer to me. Another was a friend from college. And I through asking, because I guess of my own insecurities, I'm thinking, what is affecting people? Is it the pictures of like the Easter service or something? I can't imagine what I'm putting. Well, not the people being on Facebook. And then this weekend, somebody legitimately befriended me. I'm crushed. I don't like to see it. You know, I take those things personally. So be aware. Maybe you need to stop ordering certain magazines. Maybe you need to delete certain shopping apps. Maybe you need to stop watching HGTV or whatever. I don't know what it is. Don't go to the boat show. Don't go to the car show. Don't go to the hunting show. If you find yourself in a situation where you're disliking somebody or disliking something, what they have and what you don't have, that's the problem. Instead, in the power of Christ, celebrate others' blessings. Celebrate others' blessings. I'm telling you from experience, this can only be done in prayer. This can only be done through God's strength that we have in Jesus Christ. Celebrate others' marriages. Celebrate others' jobs. Celebrate others' kids. Celebrate others' vacations, even that the Parisian family in Switzerland, which I made up, by the way, don't go like searching Facebook for that. Although I'm sure somebody's done that. Celebrate that. If you find yourself in that moment, there's something wrong in your heart, take a moment and give it to God in prayer, because there's no other way in our human strength to deal with it. And then, along with dumb comparisons, we cultivate gratitude. Philippians chapter 9 says, Proverbs chapter 15, verse 15 says this, "For the despondent, every day brings trouble. For the happy heart, life is a continual feast." If you're despondent, you will see despondent things. If you're focused on God, you will see His hand acting. Now, this isn't self-help, feel-good stuff. The idea here is that just thinking, I'm okay, you're okay, let's just all be okay together. But it is about giving to God your attitude, your heart, your life, and seeing His hand, even when you don't get what you want, which is going to be most of the time. Even when you don't get what you want. If you intend to look away at God's blessings, you will never be happy. I promise you. If you look away from God's blessings, you won't be happy no matter how much you have. On the other hand, if you resolve to seek the kingdom of God first, Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, I'm telling you, you're going to see life a different way. You will have a gratefulness. You will have a gratitude. You will have a peace as you celebrate every moment, every day. I get my perspective challenged constantly. I have a friend in a different state who's a pastor, and he loves Jesus, and he's got deep faith. We were recently having a conversation, actually via Facebook Messenger. He was complaining about some of the changes in the tax codes and the implications it might have for pastors. And he lives in a state where apparently somebody has challenged the clergy a housing allowance, and in this particular state, there's three states affected by it. A judge has approved that clergy can't get housing allowances, and I assume it will be, you know, turned down against the Supreme Court, and we're having a lot of housing allowances. But he's worried. And in the conversation we had, the confession that we both made is, listen, by every standard imaginable, we are rich. For every possible standard historically and today, we are wealthy. The reality, and I know you can challenge me with, because I understand that homeless people, I understand there's poverty in our country, but the reality is that the U.S. compared to historical norms, there's no poverty from a historical perspective. I know there is, and I don't want anybody saying, well, pastors said there's no poverty in the U.S. But I think about pastors like Osman Uniet, when we partnered with and prayed for him in Cuba, live in a literal shack. They live in a literal shack. And their house wouldn't pass our standards, or any municipality's standards anywhere. And so I ask you, do you see God's blessings, or are you always wanting more? I want to have one more verse. This is from Ecclesiastes chapter 6, verse 9. Solomon says, "Enjoy what you have, rather than desiring what you don't have. Just dreaming about nice things is meaningless, but chasing after wind." Solomon isn't saying you can never have dreams. But what he is saying, what I think God is asking us today is, are you going to miss what is for the sake of what could be? Are you missing what is for the sake of what could be? Are you constantly dreaming of a new car, a different house, home projects, a new job, a new relationship, a new this or that, and missing out on what is for what could be? The challenge is in the strength of Christ to slow down and enjoy what God is doing right now. I want to end by rereading from Philippians chapter 4, which we read earlier, a couple of verses. Again, Paul said, I know how to live on almost nothing or with everything. I've learned the secret of living in every situation, whether it was a full stomach or empty, with plenty or little, for I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength. Through Christ, through His power, kill comparisons, cultivate gratitude, see what God is doing right now. Don't miss it. Don't miss what is for the sake of what could be. Amen. Would you stand with me?